Okay, so we're here today with Lucky Lakshmanan. We are at the Fairmont Hotel. It is August 24th, 2015, and the interviewer, as usual, will be William McRae. So we're going to begin with just a very simple few questions. So first of all, could you please state your full name?
Vaikuntham Iyer Lakshmanan.
And your age, please?
75.
And where were you born exactly?
Born in India.
Whereabouts?
In Tamil Nadu, in Chennai.
Okay. And as a child, what did your parents do for a living?
My father was managing an agricultural farm. That was it. He was a landlord.
Okay. What did you grow?
Well, my early years, I was in deep south in India, in a place called Chinnavelli, near Cape Comorin, in the tip of India. After doing my grade 12 SSLs, I moved to a place called Bombay. And that's where I did my education for bachelor's, master's, and PhD.
Which was in chemistry, right?
Chemistry, that's correct.
And why chemistry?
Well, I always felt, Bill, that chemistry is a good basis from which you can move into, whether it is metallurgy or environment, process engineering, chemical engineering. A good understanding in chemistry can give you the basis to move on to various other subjects.
Yeah, it's the best science base.
Absolutely. Really.
Yeah, absolutely. And okay, so you did bachelor's, master's, and PhD all in Mumbai.
Mumbai.
And from there, was your first, I guess, official job within your career in India, or was it in Canada?
Well, Bill, my PhD was in inorganic chemistry, using a technology called solvent extraction to understand the chemistry of various things. As I was doing, I was working before I got my PhD as a chief chemist in a company. They were making inorganic pigments for tiles. So that gave an exposure using this technology, solvent extraction, making an industrial product to make glazes. So that was the beginning of my working career. Then as I did, always wanted to go abroad for further training, and got an opportunity as a postdoctoral fellow at the Department of Minerals Engineering at the University of Birmingham in England. And my PhD work on solvent extraction and separation technology, I used to work with nuclear chemistry, radioisotopes, to understand how things are happening. That gave me an opportunity to move into Birmingham, but I used the technology, moved on to minerals engineering, a separation technology and extractive metallurgy, and also set up a laboratory on radio chemical laboratory at the University of Birmingham in mouse engineering. In India, I used to get my samples irradiated at Apsara reactor and Cyrus. Went to England in minerals engineering, where I went as a postdoctoral fellow for 2 years. Used the reactors in Aldermaston to get irradiated samples to follow the similar solvent extraction technology to further understand the separation technology, separations for the metals in minerals in minerals engineering. That was a career path. Moved using the separation technology. Here I moved from chemistry to minerals engineering, which is like chemical engineering. So it moved me there in the minerals engineering. Then after 2 years, I became a lecturer at the Department of Minerals Engineering, teaching hydrometallurgy. So I moved from chemistry to minerals engineering, hydrometallurgy, which is like chemical engineering. Minerals engineering is a subject, and like chemical, you know, it's like chemical engineering. So I taught there for 3 years, and then left England in 1974, arrived in Canada as a postdoctoral fellow with CanMed. And they got a Ritzy at CanMed, the head of the HydroMed group. He was interested in the work I was doing on solvent extractions. He asked me to come here as a postdoctoral fellow for a year. So worked as a postdoctoral fellow, then moved to Noranda, and now in Point Claire, in the R&D. So I spent some time in Noranda. Then I used to work with Alan Ashbrook in CanMed, and Alan moved to El Dorado Nuclear, and he asked me to come to El Dorado Nuclear. So I moved to El Dorado Nuclear as a hydrometallurgist. So my career took me from CanMed. I was 1 year. Then went to Noranda, then went to El Dorado Nuclear. When I was in El Dorado Nuclear, William, I find myself so fortunate in this God's country called Canada. I'm born in deep south in Tamil Nadu. I got opportunity to work in places like Uranium City, north of Lake Athabasca in Saskatchewan, under 60th parallel, working in the uranium mine. And that was a unique opportunity for someone like myself coming into this country, that I was in Ottawa, but I could work at Uranium City, And also worked at the Porto plant, the refinery, Again, it is a continuing story, it was a common thread, separation technology, solvent extraction, nuclear industry, following similar process principles. Whether when you worked in Port Hope, it is the same solvent extraction technology to separate uranium coming from Uranium City, the yellowcake, and you separate it to make highly pure material to make reactor fuel, EO2 or EO6. So worked there for a few years, then I had a request from Ontario Research Foundation. So God Ritzy thought it would be useful for me to go here, a good friend of mine, God Ritzy. So I moved from Ontario, from El Dorado Nuclear, which is today Cameco. Well, what you see as Cameco today used to be El Dorado Nuclear, a Crown Corporation, that with SMDC, Saskatchewan Mining and Development Corporation, together during Brian Mulroney's time, he put these two institutions together, companies together, and formed today was one of the largest uranium reactor fuel company, uranium mining company, reactor fuel company in the world, which is involved in mining and refining, So what is Cameco today used to be El Dorado Nuclear. And after spending a few years in El Dorado Nuclear with Alan Ashbrook, I moved to Ontario Research Foundation as head of hydrometallurgy section. So that was the beginning of my association with Ontario Research Foundation. That was in 1980. And William, Ontario Research Foundation has a very, very rich history. You are a historian. It was formed in 1926, after the World War I, to increase the competitiveness of Ontario-based industries, whether it is mining, agriculture, or or forestry. The objective then was, Bill, primarily enhance the competitiveness of the major industries in Ontario and give them trained, skilled manpower, taking the graduates, postgraduate students from Ontario Business University, put them in Ontario Research Foundation, give them training to adapt and looking into challenges in this industry. So in 1926, Ontario Research Foundation was formed with a contribution from Government of Ontario and the Canadian Exporters and Manufacturers Association, CMA, as you see today. Together it was formed in 1926. And of course, Ontario Research Foundation was one of the largest, you know, technology development and research organization in Canada. You know, then you had other provincial research organizations like Alberta Research and Saskatchewan Research coming later. So that I came to, you know, head the group on hydrometallurgy. Then things took off, you know, then became a director for metallurgy group and metallurgy and environmental. And 1999 January, Ontario Research Foundation, or it became ORTEC. It became ORTEC in 1986 because the name Ontario Research Foundation, Bill, the then management felt did not truly reflect because the clients were from all over the world. It was not Ontario.
Okay.
Early days it was formed to serve the Ontario industries, but as the time went on, they had people from US and other places. And it was not a place where people were doing research. It was more on technology development and application. And it was not a foundation giving out money to anybody. It was doing client service, whether for government or private sector.
Okay.
So they felt the name was not fully fitting well with what they were doing. So they changed the name to ORTEC.
Did you play a role in that?
I was a middle management person there. And we had clients, Bill. Most of the uranium projects in Canada, ORTEC did a major role in developing, testing, and all that. So in 85, it was the new name came as ORTEC. And on the 98 December, 99 January, it was privatized. The then Premier of Ontario, Mike Harris, felt to do research and focus on universities, but organizations such as this could be supported, you know, could go out and do business for industries or government on a project basis, but not directly supporting with yearly contribution. So it was privatized in 1999. So it was bought up by a group of consortium members. And a company called Bodycode from England was one major company. And then I was involved in bringing a couple other people. So bought the group called Process Technologies Division from the old ORTEC. And then this became Process Research ORTEC.
Okay.
You know, that is the, and when it was formed, William, our focus was not doing test work, but developing solutions for clients' problems. And we wanted not to restrict ourselves only with Canada, but also see opportunities with some developing economies. So that is the story. The present Process Research ORTEC focuses on the, you know, developing solutions for clients' needs. Sometimes we do the market research and see where the problems are, and then invest our own funds to develop technologies. The earlier ORTEC would never compete with private sector because they were getting assistance from Ontario government. So they were mandated not to compete with private sector. But when it became fully privatized, so this private company now fully competes with the market. And not alone, it develops technology on its own and takes it to the market. Sometimes we also invest in commercialization. We work closely with universities, and technology is developed the universities at a small scale with the big facilities that we have. We give professors from universities opportunities for beta testing, pre-commercialization trials, and piloting. It happens in our facility. The professors from, we did a major project on polymers, on nanopolymer. The technology was developed at the University of Toronto, and it was brought to Process Resort Tech, where we did all the developmental work, beta testing, commercial testing, so they could take sizable product to test, whether it's automotive industry or consumer product, so they could do it. So the business model is not alone that we would develop the solution, but when professors at the universities need a facility where they could take it, and we have, Bill, we have connections and contact with financial institutions, so we'll introduce them to professors so they could discuss and take it to the marketplace. So basically, that is the story.
Okay.
And we serve primarily our company, Bill. As I said, we serve because the mining industry goes up and down.
Very cyclical.
And we have to buy our groceries. So we have to use the technologies we develop, but applicable to some other sectors where these process principles find usage. So we move into specialty chemicals, we move into environmental sectors and renewable energy, but we focus on clean technologies. But use, Bill, the same fundamental separation technologies, what you do, but you do the separation technologies for mining industry, what you do, or these industries need more and more, the challenges coming from various regulatory agencies, clean technology becomes an area of opportunity. And also the innovation on these industries, Bill, what I feel, I've just finished writing a book which is going to be published by Springer, brought a few people together, on innovative metallurgical processes from concept to commissioning. So it is not invention at the university, but to reach it to the marketplace, you need innovative principles in engineering, in environment, financing, understanding the market. So this is a book, Bill, which will come out in a month's time on innovative, because these industries are highly capital intensive. Innovation will pick, Canada is blessed with big, lot of resources. But for us to compete in the international marketplace, we have to have the competitive advantage. Nobody can take the ore away from us, but mining the ore alone is not enough. We have to have competitive technologies which are environmentally also very, very sustainable. So you need to have processes which are economically advantageous, but also environmentally,
What types of technologies have recently been developed by Process Research or Tech that has to do with renewable technologies or sustainable development? Because that's big with you guys right now.
Yeah, that's correct. We build a small company, we just have about 25 people, and it was formed only in, 1999. We have developed technology which will be reaching the marketplace. One we developed on titanium dioxide, which can be used for, which is a specialty chemical for, making paints.
Back to your specialty.
Correct. Early days. Yeah. So that is a unique technology we developed, which is environmentally friendly. We have developed another technology, for nickel laterites. Most of the sulfide ores are depleting. So looking for lattering oxide ores, DARP technology, which is going to be commercialized. Then Bell, we have developed a technology on water, where these industries consume a lot of water, a lot of energy. So we have developed a technology for cleaning of the water, and the demonstration plant is currently commissioned. We have formed a joint venture with a major company in India. So the pilot run, demonstration run at 1.5 million liters per day is currently running. And then their objective is to take it to various places. So water. Then we are doing another one on battery. Renewable
batteries?
For energy storage. So these are some examples, as I tell you. So, but well, I always come back to clean technology and separation technology. Our strength, we feel, is separation. Okay, and understanding the basis, what makes separation more efficiently.
For someone who's not necessarily an expert in separation technology, what's a good example of an application of separation technology?
Give you an example, Bill, on this titanium dioxide. Conventionally, it is done by using thermal processing. That's what people like DuPont and other people do. But many a time, if there are some impurities, then there is very restrictive. What feed material they can use to use the technologies. The technology we have developed, it is highly selective. So impurities that we may have, because when you talk about paint, Bill, you have to make sure the impurities are very, very, very low, because, you know, white paint, you will always see the color, you know, immediately. So you have to make sure that you separate your impurities efficiently. And using technologies like solvent extraction, Bill, I said to you, my early years from my PhD, I started with solvent extraction. I'm still at the age of 75, I still find opportunity for solvent extraction. But my understanding on the basic chemistry helps me to look for innovative ways of using these separation technologies, chemical engineering, so that you obtain a product which gets this, you know, meeting market specification. So what we did on titanium dioxide is an example. Similarly, we have come up with a technology to separate gold. You know, gold is, when you dissolve it, it's only a few ppm, but it's with a lot of other impurities. So selectively taking the gold from leach solution, you have to understand it. And we have found a way of selectively taking the gold out. And when I say ppm, parts per million, taking that from a bulk solution where you've got all the other, you know, impurities like iron and various things there. So these are some, again, the basic understanding of what is there and the solution chemistry, and then bringing in the innovative processes and marrying this understanding of the basic principles. But today, in today's world, you have new materials of construction available, and you have a lot of, you know, so we have come a long way, you know. If I started my career in 1966-67, and I worked for H&R Johnson, which is a company making lasers, which is a British company. Today, I mean, 2015, you are talking nearly 50 years, and the industry has come a long way. So when you talk about materials of construction, simulation, modeling, you know, a lot of other things available. So it helps you to, but what is very, very important, as I see it, Canada is a country blessed with a lot of resources. And for us to sustain and compete in the international marketplace, what is very, very important, Bill, is having a good strength on the basics, and also bringing the modern technologies like simulation, modeling, and computer you know, enabling technologies in the digitized world, and innovation for this industry to sustain. Innovation, and when you look upon that in the digitized world, things Apple or other guys will come, the shelf life is very short. Mining industry, when you develop something, the shelf life is very, very long. The technology in some sector, what they use may be 50 years old. But as you go along, the regulatory conditions may be much, much more tighter. And the feed material you may bring today may be much more complex. So you have to understand what you need to do. So you have to be innovative. And some of these things are in distant location, where infrastructure is very poor, so you have to do various things. And you also have, in the digitized world, you can be sitting in Toronto and may be able to run a plant, whether it's Timmins or Newfoundland or Northwest Territories. Because young people want to have the comfort. In my days, when it was a uranium city, there were only 3,000 people. So when the mine closed, all those 3,000 people had no other job. But today, you've got to fly in and fly out. People from Montreal work for Agnico Eagle in Nunavut. Mm-hmm. So, you know, 2 weeks in, 2 weeks out.
Yeah, I have many friends from the East Coast who work in Alberta.
Alberta. So today, Bill, the situation has changed. For me to go to Uranium City during those years, I used to go to Edmonton International Airport, go to Municipal Airport, and take a DC-3, DC-4, go to Uranium City. But today, well, people working there from Saskatoon, they could fly into whether Key Lake or McLean, fly in and fly out. In our time, there is no direct flight from Saskatoon to anywhere. But today, of course, you know, we have come a long way. So in the digital economy, Bill, for our industry, the resource sector, you know, nobody can take away our woes from underground. But Canada is in a unique position where we have Bay State Financial Wizards there. We have things like PDAC happening. We have people with good experience, world-class engineering companies like Hatch in Canada. So you marry all this, we are uniquely in an advantageous position for us in Canada to continue to create the knowledge jobs. You know, so mining is not just digging a hole in the ground and shoveling it and taking it out. But with our unique experience, we can put the whole package together. You know, raise the finance from Bay Street. They got TSX where you can list and do what you can. We got a PDAC where you are able to bring people together. Then, of course, you've got Hatch Engineering some other, you know, I'm talking about Canadian Engineering Company, BBA and other people. So we can create the knowledge jobs. The unique advantage because the resources, whether you talk about mining or energy or, they're blessed. They got the hydro power, they got fossil, they got nuclear. All the energy and renewable also, they're getting in, Canadian solar and other companies. So Canada is uniquely qualified, but for our industry to sustain, we have to invest in innovation. We lost companies like Falcon Bridge, Alcan, Miranda, Inco. They're all history. But for us to continue, to survive, I strongly feel, we got good company. We still have Barrick, Sherry, Tech, our own Canadian companies there, Agrico Eagle, a lot of companies coming up, and there will be a lot more opportunities. But what is very important, Bill, is we have to pay attention to innovation. We have to understand the digitized world, and then also the human capability and help them with the quality of life. Canada is the envy of the world in terms of our quality of life. For us to sustain that quality of life, we have to invest in innovation. We have to understand the whole thing, and the industry can help us creating wealth and jobs.
Absolutely. Do you think it's an issue though that the general public, I am speaking generally, but the general public does think of mining as simply holes in the ground and don't necessarily understand what goes into mining, for example, the finance, the research, all of this stuff that most people, first of all, might not even know exists, or at least not understand.
I think, Bill, this is, it's a very good question what you're asking. We ourselves have to do a lot more, go and reach out to the communities and tell them all the good work we are doing. You know, you should go to mining companies normally. There's a lot of good things happening underground, even automation, the trucks are going, a lot of things are happening, but we have not done enough probably to go and give the message. We are creating the wealth. We have to go and tell people all the good work we do, and we support communities in distant locations. And we should feel very proud of what we're doing. You know, Canada is not Toronto and Vancouver and Montreal. We, supporting industries in Timmins, in industries in Nunavut or Yellowknife. And I mean, mining industry is keeping Canada together. Jobs are not always in Toronto and Vancouver. Mining industry, if you talk about Valdor or Agrigo Eagle, when they do in Nunavut, or people from Montreal, the skilled workers from Montreal, go and run the gold operation in Nunavut. So they're uniquely qualified, but maybe we have to take the message more and more to the community and tell them how blessed we are in Canada and how the great mining industry is supporting. I think we have to do
a bit more effort from the mining's perspective.
Because that's my opinion.
Yeah, no, that's true. Because if there's the second there's a hiccup or something, that's what the media likes.
Exactly.
They never like to share the good things.
Absolutely.
It's not as interesting.
Absolutely. Bill, look at what some of the companies have done. Companies like Barrick, started as a small company. Today is one of the world's, one of the best.
Yeah.
And a company like Sherritt. Sherritt, anywhere in the world you go, they use Sherritt technology, So we should feel very, very proud. Hatch, one of the best engineering company in the world. And, it is not just a booking maneuvers. Hatch does also technology. So we have lots of gems amongst us, and we have to go and tell this to the world, how good we are and how we are, aggressively saying, we can deliver the solution efficiently.
Mm-hmm. Question on a completely different topic here. Throughout your career, and that might have changed, how present or absent were women? But you started in chemistry, which is unique. Maybe there were more women, I don't know.
Can I say women? But when I went to England, my association with Faculty of Chemistry, I moved on to minerals engineering when I went to England. During those years, I used to take myself and Alan Roselor, used to take students for field trips. But in a cage, they'll never take women underground. Things are changing now. So, early years, engaging, women in some of these departments. But things are changing. Even the university population, you see a lot more women coming into engineering faculties. Many years back, that was not the case. So things are changing. And also now you've got people from different parts of the world coming. That also is giving you a different perspective of how things are happening. Peggy Vitti, who hired me to come to Ontario Research Foundation, she was a metallurgist lady, and but not enough women. Women are let's say 50% of the population are women, but that is not totally reflected in
natural resources. Yeah. Sure. What are you proudest of in life? Let's say in your professional life. If there's a few, that's okay as well.
Proud about?
Yeah, whether it's a great achievement or a patent or a company, anything.
Well, two things I would say, Bill. One is getting a PhD in chemistry from Bombay University. When I became a lecturer in minerals engineering in 1972 at Birmingham University, I felt, you know, somebody coming with a chemistry degree from a foreign university getting recognized for
in England.
That was something, you know. Then the second thing, Bill, I feel is you know, in Canada, how Canada is very welcoming, people coming from elsewhere. And I was able to put together a team of people and form this company, a small company. It's a small company, but still the opportunity came. And that company today is in the field of innovation for the knowledge economy. So somebody got off the boat in 1974 in this country has come a long way to participate in creating wealth and giving jobs. You know, so giving back to the community.
Mm-hmm.
That I feel, Bill, is pretty rewarding. And Canada is one of the very few countries in the world where you can be doing that. And I also make it a point, when I hire people, new immigrants, give them a job, give them work experience. Then they can go anywhere they want. Okay? Then, of course, some of the other things, what is happening now, Bill, using your technology, whether it is, you know, when you see these companies going to be producing titanium dioxide or nickel or water, these are all things that you continuously, passionately chase innovation and the innovation to bring solution. But these companies have to run, make money and happen. That's the story. But it's a process. So till all these companies commission and run, I can't say anything. But I had an opportunity to take it to the market. What happens afterwards is a story.
Do you still work full time? Okay. You guys in the in these fields don't like to retire.
Well, you know, as long as you can continue to engage and be productive. That's very important. You know, it's a private company, and if you cannot fully keep yourself engaged and make it productive, then you should just get out.
Mm-hmm.
Or tell how this happened.
Yeah.
Alex McLean is a director of my company, so so people like Alex is. An amazing guy.
Yeah, very nice guy. I interviewed him as well.
Yeah. I'm also an adjunct professor at the University of Toronto with Alex. So it gives me an opportunity to be with students, meet the students.
What you've taught a few times now, so you taught in Birmingham as well. Is there a specific class or a thing you like to teach that really stays with you?
You see, the area I focus on separation technologies.
Mm-hmm.
Separation technologies, whether it is primary ore or secondary. With separation, whether making a product or separation to make water clean or some solid materials non-toxic. So it's a separation technology, but whether it is for environmental purpose, or processing, you know, in the University of Toronto, the class I was doing was environmental management. It's again separation.
Okay.
Yeah.
If you were to speak to someone much younger, like a student, for example, what would be the one piece of advice or life lesson you could give them right now about their professional future?
One thing, Bill, I would say is you have to be a good team player. You have to be very communicative. the skills you learn in the university gives you, a job. But how you move on your job depends on how efficient are you in communicating and be a team player. So, you know, one advice I would give to anybody is make sure that you work with people, understand people, and make the project a success. You know, enough that you are an Einstein, but it should be more like Wayne Gretzky, working with people, receiving the puck and scoring, so the team is winning. You know, I always compare tennis and hockey. In tennis, McEnroe may be winning, it's only McEnroe. But when you go to hockey or basketball, it's a team sport. You always need somebody to feed so the guy can score or put the puck. So what is very important in today's world is soft skill is very important. You need to have a strength in your domain, but you also have to be a good
team player. Cooperation.
Very, very important.
Thank you. Is there anything else you'd like to add or share?
I mean, I think that's all.
Well, Dr. Lakshmanan, thank you very much.
Thank you, Bill.